I am honored and deeply humbled to host this event today to share Burma's Path to Genocide, the museum's newest exhibition, with the public. The exhibition explores how the Rohingya, a Muslim minority, went from citizens to outsiders and became targets of a sustained campaign of genocide. This exhibition, available online and in person, shares the experiences of individuals, fathers, mothers, wives, brothers, from Mungnu, a village in northern Rakhine State in western Burma. But importantly, the exhibition doesn't focus on one day of violence in August 27, 2017, when the Burmese military, called the Tatmadaw, attacked Rohingya men, women, and children as part of a wider campaign of genocide. The exhibition tells the story of the Rohingya people, what they had, how they thrived, how they lived, as well as the immeasurable loss. Visitors can hear from Rohingya survivors today and learn about the trauma they bear, their hopes for justice, and a peaceful future. Burmese authorities have tried to erase the Rohingya people from the country. We wanted to work with Rohingya colleagues to fight against this erasure, and instead share the stories from this community with the world to honor the dignity of the victims and survivors and guard against genocide denial. This exhibition provides space for reflection as a global community about our collective failure to prevent genocide. The museum has warned for many years about the risk of genocide and mass atrocities being perpetrated against the Rohingya. The museum issued a report detailing these risks in 2015 and 2017. In December of 2018, the museum determined that genocide had been perpetrated against the Rohingya. The situation today facing the Rohingya community is grim. Over 700,000 Rohingya who fled Burma from neighboring Bangladesh continue to live in crowded and dangerous conditions. And those who remain in Burma are again at risk of mass atrocities following the February 2021 coup by Burma's military. The same generals who were responsible for genocide and crimes against humanity against the Rohingya have now taken the reins of power. Today and in years past, many communities are being attacked by the Tatmadaw, including other ethnic minorities. In October of 2021, the United Nations Special Rapporteur on Burma, Tom Andrews, said in reference to the buildup of troops in northern Burma, "These tactics are ominously reminiscent of those employed by the military before its genocidal attacks against the Rohingya in Rakhine State in 2016 and 2017. Too many communities across Burma know full well the brutality of the Tatmadaw, which according to the Assistance Association for Political Prisoners has killed approximately 865 people and imprisoned over 7,880 people since the coup on February 1st. These perpetrators are enjoying long-standing impunity for their atrocities. But thanks to the leadership of individuals with us today at this event, that might change. There is hope on the horizons as our speakers here today are pursuing new creative efforts to pursue justice for the Rohingya people and ensure that a future Burma protects their rights. It is my honor to introduce Susan Worsinger, a Holocaust survivor who volunteers at the museum. Susan recorded her remarks and will briefly tell us about her experiences as well as her message to the Rohingya community. Let's hear from Susan in her own words.
My name is Susan Worsinger. I am a Holocaust survivor and longtime museum volunteer. I was born in Bad Kreuznach, Germany in 1929 to a loving Jewish family. We were an observant Jewish family, attending synagogue almost every Saturday, preparing the traditional dishes for the Sabbath, and observing all the Jewish holidays with great enthusiasm. My father owned and operated a thriving linen store, providing a comfortable lifestyle for my younger brother and me. This all changed in 1933 when Hitler and the Nazi Party came to power and started implementing anti-Semitic laws. Slowly, we became outsiders. As a result of state-sanctioned boycotts, my father lost his linen store. I was bullied by my peers in school because I was Jewish, and eventually I was prohibited from attending public school altogether. Fortunately, members of the Jewish community came together to ensure we were educated. While I was just a little girl, rocks were thrown at me while I was walking through a park. The gatekeeper and his young daughter hurled anti-Semitic remarks at me, and I was ordered out of the premises because Jews were not allowed in public parks. On Kristallnacht, the night of the broken glass, an angry mob smashed through our front door, and we had to hide in the attic for a number of days because we were afraid for our lives. Our synagogue was burned down, and all the Jewish men of our town, including my father and rabbi, who lived in the apartment of Ilos, were sent to jail. There was anti-Semitism everywhere. After Kristallnacht, my parents sent my brother Joseph and me to France so that we would be safe from the increased violence that they were certain was coming. They used their life savings to pay a French woman to smuggle us across the border. My brother was only 8 years old at the time. I was 9. Initially, we stayed with a distant cousin in Paris, but it was soon clear he was unable to care for us, so we spent 2 years in the care of strangers in various parts of France. Although we wrote to our parents during this time, we never received a response and worried about them constantly. In 1941, we received a word that our parents, along with our baby brother, had successfully immigrated to the United States with the help of organizations like the Hebrew Immigrant Aid Society, the American Friends Services Committee, and the United States Committee for the Care of European Children. My brother and I received permission to emigrate to the United States. We arrived in New York in September of that year, and we were reunited with our family. Although my immediate family survived the horrors of the Holocaust, most of my relatives were murdered. After the Holocaust, we vowed never again. Sadly, that promise has not been fulfilled. As a Holocaust survivor, I'm extremely concerned about the persecution of the Rohingya population in Burma. Just as we experienced anti-Semitic hate speech and violence, the Rohingya have been the targets of widespread anti-Muslim rhetoric. Just as we were ostracized in Germany, the Burmese government has excluded the Rohingya from participating in society and has subjected them to extreme violence. We must speak out against mass atrocities taking place in Burma because the Rohingya are at risk of mass atrocities by Burma's military, who are at the helm of the country. Many Rohingya have fled to Burma, from Burma to Bangladesh, where they are crowded in camps and face serious security risks. The Simon Scott Center for the Prevention of Genocide works to do for the victims of genocide today what the world failed to do for the Jews in Europe when I was a young child in the 1930s and 1940s. I am so proud of the work of the museum is doing to bring awareness to the plight of the Rohingya people in Burma, and grateful to all of you for attending this special event to learn more about this community at risk. We must work together to end the suffering of these individuals and make the promise of never again a reality for all people at risk of being targeted for mass violence, even genocide, simply for who they are.
Thank you, Susan, for your incredibly powerful and personal remarks. It is now my honor to introduce Senator Todd Young of Indiana and Senator Ben Cardin of Maryland. Senator Young is the ranking member of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee Near East, South, and Central Asia Subcommittee. Earlier this year, along with Senators Merkley and Durbin, Senator Young led Congress in condemning the coup in Burma. He has been leader in the Senate for calling for justice and accountability for the Rohingya people. Senator Young is a key supporter of genocide prevention issues and a frequent ally of the museum. Senator Cardin is a senior member of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee and a staunch defender of global human rights issues. In 2017, he spearheaded the effort to introduce and pass the Elie Wiesel Genocide and Atrocity Prevention Act, which provides atrocities prevention training to State Department officials. The Elie Wiesel Act represents just one of his many accomplishments as a senator and foreign policy expert. We're fortunate to frequently collaborate with Senator Cardin, who is also a member of the museum's governing council, and we are eager to hear from him today. Let's hear from Senator Young and Senator Cardin.
I'm United States Senator Todd Young of Indiana. I regret not being able to join you in person tonight for the grand opening of your new exhibit. I applaud the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum's commitment to shedding light on the horrific events happening in Burma. For years, the Burmese military has engaged in a campaign of terror and oppression against the Rohingya people. In the U.S. Senate, I've worked with my colleagues to condemn the military coup in Burma, as well as the systematic campaign of persecution and atrocities against the Rohingya and other ethnic minorities. These efforts would be aided by the swift adoption of the resolution I introduced with Senator Merkley that urges the president to declare the abuses constitute genocide. That resolution, in a recent letter I wrote with Senator Merkley to Secretary of State Blinken with the same request, were directly educated by the incredible work the Simon Scott Center has done cataloging these abuses. These efforts are not just based on values, but because what is happening in Burma hits close to home. My home state of Indiana is home to the largest Burmese population in the United States. And the city of Fort Wayne is home to the largest group of Rohingya Muslims in America. The Rohingya people continue to face real and imminent risk, and the United States must act to demonstrate global leadership and stand boldly against these genocidal tactics that have no place in civilized society. I will continue the important work in the United States Senate to protect vulnerable populations from genocide. Thank you to the Simon Scott Center for the Prevention of Genocide and all of you who made this important exhibit possible.
Hi, I'm Senator Ben Cardin of Maryland, and I am a member of the United States Holocaust Memorial Council. I want to congratulate the Holocaust Memorial Museum for the opening of the powerful new Rohingya exhibit, Burma's Path to Genocide. This well-curated exhibit explores how the Rohingya people went from fully participating citizens of a newly independent Burma in the 1950s to targets of a long-running military-led campaign of evisceration, expulsion, and murder. Throughout its independence, Burma's history has suffered decades of repressive military rule and civil war with ethnic minorities. And what we are seeing today in Burma, especially since the coup d'etat on February 1st of this year, is no different. Which is why I recently introduced the Burma Act of 2021 with 18 of my Senate colleagues. The bill seeks to achieve accountability for the Rohingyas, including authorizing increased humanitarian assistance for Rohingya refugees and requesting the State Department to make a formal genocide determination regarding their persecution. The United States should lead the world in calling what has happened and what continues to unfold by its name, a genocide. And I hope many, many people will take the time to view this fascinating, disheartening, tragic tale. I want to thank the Holocaust Museum again for featuring this exhibit, as it is important to ensure that the ongoing persecution of the Rohingya is not forgotten. I continue to stand in solidarity with the people of Burma and condemn the ongoing violence against them.
Thank you, Senator Young and Cardin, for the important reminder that this is not just a Burmese issue, this is an American issue. I'd like to now turn to our conversation, and it is my profound honor to introduce some very close friends of the museum and partners. We're joined by three Rohingya advocates who have worked very closely as advisors to the exhibit and have been long partners for us in our work. Wei Wei Nu, the founder and executive director of the Women's Peace Network. Yasmin Ula, Rohingya human rights activist, and she's on the steering committee of Bridges MM. And Thun Kin, president of the Burmese Rohingya Organization of the UK. We're also fortunate to be joined by the exhibit's curator, Greg Constantine, an award-winning photojournalist who has spent over a decade dedicated to telling the story of the Rohingya people and documenting them. I want to thank all of the viewers who are watching online. You can submit your questions in the comment section on Facebook. Our staff will answer them there. A recording of today's event will also be available online and will be available in the Rohingya language, Burmese, and Arabic in the coming days. I'd like to start with a first question for you, Wei Wei. Why is it important to highlight the stories and the history of the Rohingya community and an exhibit like this?
Thank you so much, Naomi. First of all, I would like to say my thanks and appreciation and gratitude to the museum for creating this incredible exhibit to highlight, to bring the light to the suffering of our people, Rohingya. Thank you so much for that. And I'd like to thank Suzanne and Senator Young and Curran for their remarks and for their concerns and effort for our people. To answer your question, I think it is when we think about the Rohingya genocide, one of the things that the military has successfully done is to eliminate our stories, our history, and to make us vulnerable so that we can't even talk about our stories. So these are some of the goals that they have in mind, eliminating our history and to eliminate our community, our people of our existence, and to shut us up so that when they make us so vulnerable, we cannot even share our story and we cannot even express ourselves. And that's what their objective and goal. And now, highlighting, bringing this back to life, telling the history of Rohingya and sharing our stories, it's so important for us because so that we can tell the world what is happening to us as well as our people themselves can somehow feel empowered and exist and recognized by the world. As well as, I think it will also give us a sense of, like, when the military has this goal of eliminating our history and to create a picture of us, like, with the propaganda and with their campaign, like, you know, inside Myanmar, presenting our people as enemy of the state and basically bad people in many forms with a lot of derogatory descriptions against our people. When people started to see who we are as a distinct ethnic community, distinct group, which have rich of culture and tradition, I think it can give us some sort of platform to bridge humanity to the rest of the world and in inside Myanmar, most importantly inside Myanmar. Because the battle we have is in Myanmar to bridge the gap of hate and love and our existence and the denial of our existence. And this can only be able to bring back when we are able to tell to the people of Burma and the world who we are and who we were and what happened to our people. So this will give a lot of opportunity for us domestically inside Myanmar to end genocide, as well as I truly hope that this will lead to the discussion. This will lead to the discussion for justice and accountability for the survivors and victims, mainly, especially the 1 million Rohingya survivors in Bangladesh refugee camps. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that, Wei Wei, and just for reminding us, you know, so many of us take for granted the fact that we can exist and that we can exist as a people and we can define our own identity and have that identity expressed. For the Rohingya community and for those who are watching, it's important to just remind people that the Rohingya were citizens in Burma. You had your citizenship taken away in the early 1980s. There was an intentional effort by the government to use laws to restrict your rights, restrict freedom of movement, the ability for you to get higher education, to marry, physical restrictions, people put into essentially detention centers and large open air camps as we get up until the recent time period. But also there's been a really intentional effort to just even eliminate basic things like the use of the term Rohingya. In the country right now, the term that's used is Bengali. And one of the things that I think is really so important in the work that you're doing and in the exhibit and the work that Greg has been doing is to make sure that people remember that you have a long, vibrant history in the country, a vibrant culture. And despite the efforts by the government to eliminate that, despite the efforts by those in other parts of society to denigrate that, you exist. So I think that's a really important point and reminder, and I think it does serve to inspire, and we'll hear more about some of the justice efforts. Greg, I wanted to turn,
basically what Susan shared, you know, it was a process, long, decades-long process of creations of our community from the citizens to the outsiders. And I think telling the history here on Rohingya also shows the length of persecutions that our people are continue to suffer and the gravity and the intensity of our suffering as well. So I think it is very, very critical.
Thank you for that, Wei Wei. Greg, a lot of this remarkable exhibit is thanks to your incredible work and storytelling. The exhibit focuses on some of the most violent crimes kind of known to humankind. How did you approach the project, especially in a way to ensure that the way in which the community was portrayed and survivors were portrayed did not reflect a violent, degrading, or kind of reductive expression of the experiences?
First, thank you very much for having me here. And it's just such an honor to be sitting here with the three of you on this occasion. You know, when the violence broke out in 2017, I think the scale, the scope, the fury of it was really unprecedented to a degree. When you ask Rohingya to tell you the experience of what happened to them during that year, their stories are almost unimaginable. The horror, the terror, the death, the violence that was all intertwined in 2017 was pretty extraordinary. And I think in 2017, for the most part, most people in the world first became aware of who the Rohingya were because of that violence. But when you ask Rohingya, or at least in my experience of working and documenting the Rohingya for 14 years, when you ask them to actually share the story of what's happened to their community, it goes just beyond 2017. That experience of violence takes on a whole different kind of form that evaded the headlines for decades. It takes on the form of violence of being denied the right to get married, denied the right to travel, denied the right to be able to go to university and get educated. I mean, all those forms of violence that Rohingya share with you about what's happened to their community over decades and decades and decades clearly shows you that 2017 is an important part of the story, but it isn't what defines the violence and the crime of what's happened to the Rohingya community over all of these years. And so it was incredibly important to me coming into this experience of working with this amazing team of people at the Holocaust Museum and collaborating with people from the Rohingya community as to how best to tell the story of the Rohingya. And while 2017 rests central in this story of the exhibition, it doesn't define the story that we've tried to tell about what's happened to the Rohingya all these years. And those stories of those forms of violence that don't particularly take on a physical form are something that's actually really central to people really understanding what's happened to the Rohingya community all these years. And that was a really important decision that I felt we made. It was an important part of the visual process as a photographer over all of these years as to how the story could be told. And more importantly, it's taking 14 years worth of stories and filtering them all into this experience that people have when they go in to learn about what's happened to the Rohingya in this exhibition. The voices of the Rohingya were crucial to this exhibition. To share not just what happened with 2017, but more importantly, all those things that people need to know to understand what led to 2017 actually being able to happen. And those were some of the decisions that I think we made with the exhibition. And for me as a photographer, they were things that it took a long time to kind of come to the realization that the crime of genocide is not just what happened in 2017, but it's this long, incremental, and mostly invisible process of persecution that opens up a window for this fury and violence and scale and scope to actually take place in 2017.
I mean, Greg, I have to thank you just for how inclusive and ethical your approach has been to trying to share with the world the experience of the Rohingya community, something we're very sensitive to. The fact that we often talk about 6 million Jews being killed, 1 million Rohingya having to flee. Each one of those people have a story, have a lived experience, and all too often it gets reduced to just a number or a statistic. And so part of the goal is to remind people, as you said before, of the human face of what we're talking about. You also show a lot of images of people in kind of proud and happy moments as well. And I wanted to just touch, there's one photo that we showed of an elderly gentleman, a broadcaster. Do you mind just quickly sharing his experience?
Yeah, his name is Irshad. And when I met him in the camps, he was over 100 years old. But I think that his story is so representative of, again, this, what all of you have talked about for so many years, and that is this persecution, but almost this erasure of the Rohingya and their place in Burmese society. Irshad in the 1960s was someone who was part of the Rohingya language broadcast, which Rohingya are always turned back to and are incredibly proud of this broadcast in Rohingya history. At least that's what they share with me. The fact is that was a representation of how the Rohingya were actually included within larger Burmese society at that particular period of time. That language program in the 1960s was eliminated, and it was one piece of the puzzle, of the process of eliminating the Rohingya from Burmese society. When I met Irshad in the refugee camps in 2018, he talked about that experience of being a broadcaster. He passed away about a year ago in the camps, not on the soil of his homeland. But also, he is an important representation of something that the Rohingya community had at a period of time, but then was taken away. And he's a crucial part of the exhibition, and I think in the story that we're trying to tell in the exhibition.
It's truly remarkable, and also to be able to hear his voice. The exhibition also make sure to share with the world the Rohingya language, music, again, to remind people just of that lived fully lived life. Picking up on the sentiment of him not being able to go back to Burma, Yasmin, I wanted to ask you about conditions today in Bangladesh. Over a million people have had to flee, not just the violence of 2017, but four decades of violence. And on the last trip that we took as a museum, myself and my colleague Kira Fox went to Bangladesh. We met with people who fled not just 2017, but also violence in 1992, and saw the sense of loss and desperation of hope around their ability to ever return home, because to return home would be to continue to face a risk of genocide. Can you share a little bit about what conditions are like today?
One single word I could describe the conditions in the camp is dire, and dire in all of the angles that we could probably explore it. I'm talking about necessities that people are, you know, in need of to sustain themselves being, you know, inadequate. And that's just the beginning of it. From the perspective of a people who just came from, you know, or survived a mass atrocity of this scale, having to basically settle themselves into this huge piece of land in a crowded conditions, where infrastructures, sewage, you know, water, food are all inadequate. It does something psychologically. It affects us in a lot of different ways. And that slowly manifests itself to this day, in how the hopes and the, you know, the dreams of the better future is slowly dwindling. And I think that it has a lot to do with our inability to exercise our agency, to actually tell the world, to actually get people to pay attention. And this is why the museum exhibit today is such an important memorialization of what Rohingya has gone through, who we were, and now where we're heading. The conditions in the camps are, dare I say, just another part of the continuation of genocide. Because if, you know, people are left to survive, left to just figure things out on their own under very restrictive conditions and very, you know, lacking in terms of assistance from international community who are responsible for not preventing the crimes of genocide, they are left to deal with not only the conditions, you know, that are at hands in front of them, but also the memory, the thoughts, the feelings, the family separation, the trauma, the pain of having to leave home and having to leave mostly, you know, loved ones and those who have been killed during the genocidal campaigns of 2017. So that has continued on, and people are not getting enough assistance in terms of counseling, psychological support, and we're slowly seeing that, you know, changing the conditions of the camps to be a lot more hostile and a lot more conducive to even worse, outset of just people losing hope and people just thinking that this is it, there is no way out. And they are trying to innovate in a way that is probably not going to help rebuild the community. And so I really hope that when our brothers and sisters in the camps today see, you know, the exhibit, they would be able to see themselves represented, and they would be able to, you know, get some solace that there are people out here that actually care. And, you know, those who are out here who actually want the best for them.
Thank you for that, Yasmin. One of the things we tried to do, and that all of you participated in, is make sure that this exhibit is available for people to see in the camps. That's, of course, difficult because of restrictions and access to internet. That has been an endemic problem since people have had to flee, but also that it's available in the Rohingya language so people can see that their stories are being shared with the world. That sense of feeling abandoned is something that we've heard all too often over and over and over again. But as you were saying, the situation in the camps is so desperate and so dire. We have got people who are facing physical insecurity, women, girls who feel threatened, You have a situation where over 3/4 of the children have no access to education. So what that means for the future of the Rohingya community that's already been so devastated, but also faced with the tragic reality that there are too few countries in the world that want to take in refugees, Rohingya, who have survived genocide. So we're confronted with then that question of, can people go home? And if so, when, how? But conditions within Burma remain also incredibly dangerous. I wanted to turn to you, Tun Kin, if you could share with us, what is the situation like for the up to 600,000 Rohingya who remain in the country right now, especially after the coup that took place?
Thank you, Naomi. First of all, I would like to thank Holocaust Memorial Museum, this historic exhibition. I feel this is very historic. This will remain in our memories. This is what our people suffered many decades. This is quite a combination of all the persecution, historical, our existence, denial all. And thanks to Greg, you are amazing. You have done a great job, and I'm very happy today. When I enter to the exhibition, I remember in this is such a thing we didn't have in the past. When people see this, it's a big advocacy work, educating to the people. This is fantastic. And when we talk about, we look 600,000 Rohingyas in Arkana State right now. They are face a risk of genocide. They are. And to be honest, after the coup, situation getting much worse. And we have to look at the coup leader is architect of genocide. And I don't think Rohingyas can return from Bangladesh to Burma anytime soon. So the situation you asked about, these 600,000 people, for so long they are living in open prison. After the coup, now we have seen last few weeks ago, they resumed all more restrictions against Rohingya, violating international code of justice provisional measures. They don't care. And health and medical care, much more restriction we are facing. Education, of course, Rohingyas are the same situation. And 120,000 IDPs in situ in southern part of Arkana State, they are still the situation the same as squalid condition and humanitarian aid not getting properly. And also we have seen, sweating sea, those family pictures are taking on now. And anytime military can create violence against Rohingya, that is very worrying, because the best way, this military junta always try to divert the attention. So Rohingyas are the main victims to do that. So this is important from international community side. We have to, take in actions against this Burmese military before too late. I would say we lost everything. Our people, we own our lands, we have our culture, we have our civilization. Today we are seeing the people in the camps, 1 million people. And I was talking to, Greg yesterday. We are in this building in 2013 exhibition. We're talking about 130,000 IDPs. Today we are talking about 1 million people lost their homes, all the lands been taken away, their brothers been slaughtered, their children been burned alive, our sisters been raped, And it's been 4 years, and we're talking about action until today for the determination of what is this, what's happened to these people. And still, you know, I'm very, very grateful for this exhibition. Same time, I feel that international community is not doing enough, where we never know 600,000 Rohingyas living in our current state. We are receiving everyday messages and phone calls from WhatsApp and Vibers. We never know what's happened to them. Anytime soon, the risk is there. Thank you. I stop here.
Thank you for that, Chunkin. You know, I think what's really painful, and just for everyone who's watching, just to remember, is we're talking about your families, each of you. We're talking about 600,000 people whose day-to-day existence is incredibly tenuous and vulnerable. And as Chunkin said, there are 120,000 people who are internally displaced by prior fighting, who face even more insecurity. And as you mentioned, and just for those who are watching, you referred to the provisional measures. There's actually a case before the International Court of Justice that was brought forward remarkably by the Gambia, alleging genocide perpetrated by the government of Myanmar and the military. And part of that court case has led to what are called provisional measures. The government of Myanmar, the military of Myanmar, are supposed to take steps to prevent genocide. But as you said, every single day they violate those provisional measures. And remarkable work that your organizations have done, organizations like Fortify Rights in the last week, have shown that there's actually been even new orders, as you said, further restricting freedom of movement for the Rohingya community. So this is something that every single day is a lived reality, and it takes us back to that failure to prevent. I just want to pause for one moment just to remind everyone who's watching that you can submit your questions online in the comments section, and our staff will answer them there. I want to raise that question of prevention. You talked about a conversation that you had with Greg in 2013 when you were looking at displaced communities. Weiwei and I met in 2014 in Geneva at the Human Rights Council, where we were talking about genocide and the risks of genocide against the Rohingya community. The museum, my colleague Andrea Gittleman, has documented multiple times the warning signs, the risk factors. It's not a situation where we can say that the world did not know. That's always a convenient kind of refrain. And even with the access and restriction accesses, we've seen the photos that Greg has taken. We saw photos before of what it's like to live behind barbed wire. It's a failure to actually live up to our values that we expressed after the end of the Holocaust to actually commit to never again. And I wanted to ask to you, what can be done now? I'd like each of you to just kind of comment from your own perspective, from the vantage point of the work that you do. What can be done now to prevent future mass atrocities against the Rohingya? And what type of future could then be possible for the Rohingya community? Why don't we actually start with Weiwei?
Thank you, Naomi. This is a great question. So we are already late, and we are losing time, and we have no time to wait to act. We need action now. As you mentioned, as Ko Tonkin said, you know, the world has, we've been informing the world all this year, and the informations are out there and documentations are out there. And yet there is no concerted actions. Right now, we need concerted actions more than ever. Why? Because the military that committed genocide against our people now back in power and attempting to control the country. And the Rohingya are once again at risk of atrocity crimes. The military is actually promoting the anti-Rohingya hate campaign and anti-Muslim hate campaign in Myanmar since they have staged a coup. And in Rakhine State, the military has actually reintroduced more repressive measures against the Rohingya populations, including the travel restrictions that you have mentioned. And since the military coup to until now, at least over 601 individual Rohingya people have been arrested, that include majority of those detainees are female. Just the crimes is just for attempting to escape the genocidal Rakhine state. For traveling outside of Rakhine state, they have been arrested and punished to, most of them are sentenced to 2 years of imprisonment. At the same time, all of the local orders in Rakhine state and limitation restrictions on the Rohingya's livelihood in all aspects have resumed. So all of the patterns that we have seen early 2016 and 15, we are seeing again now. And therefore, we really need to take actions that include recognitions of the crime as it is. The United States government need to recognize the Rohingya genocide as it is. They have documented, they have done research. This is a time to recognize. Only when we recognize the crime will we be able to bring justice for the survivors and victims. Without recognitions of the crimes, we won't be able to see the future of Rohingya or that justice. It will be the same thing as Burmese military denying our history, our existence, and our identity. If you recognize our genocide, you will be supporting the Burmese military narrative. So that's the first thing that I want to say. Second, there are many other things that you can do, including supporting Rohingya in many ways, whatever you can, including, you know, our communities, as we discussed before, created to be so vulnerable. We don't have access to education, access to anything in life that, you know, you have here in this country. So you can help us to build our community again by directly supporting us with education, with, you know, skills and financial support and all of the things that, you know, needed for us to build back our community. That's the second thing that we require. The last thing is the entire world. You know, I think it's not just the responsibility of United States, it's the responsibility of the entire world, all people and all governments, and the United Nations itself. The United Nations should act. The obligations under the United Nations framework, including the responsibility to protect from people from the genocide and crimes against humanity and war crimes. And we have all the warning signs and signs, as well as we have crimes already done, damage already done. And this is the responsibility of the United Nations Security Council to act and to refer situations of the Myanmar to the International Criminal Court. I'll leave it here and thank you.
Thank you so much for that, Weiwei, and just for reminding us too of the importance of actually calling crimes for what they are, to push back on the narrative by the government. But also, as you said, the US government itself in 2018 undertook a really groundbreaking investigation, interviewing close to 1,100 survivors in Bangladesh to understand more about the crimes, what took place. They have the evidence. And as you said, your community's been waiting and demanding for recognition of what happened, and also for just talking about the responsibility to protect, which of course in 2001, Canada led the effort to advance the responsibility to protect. Every single government agreed that governments have a responsibility to protect their own populations from genocide, war crimes, crimes against humanity, and ethnic cleansing. Every single government.
One more thing, I think the last thing. If we don't act, if we don't bring justice for the Rohingya, we will see a lot more recurrence of crimes against, not only against the Rohingya, but also against many other communities and the entire country. Right now, this very same military is terrorizing the entire country and committing crimes against humanity. And that is the very reason that we need to take actions against them. We need to hold them accountable.
So picking up on that theme, Yasmin, your thoughts on what can be done to prevent?
I'm going to take a little bit of a segue from what Weiwei has said. I agree with everything that has been said so far. And yes, we should not anymore mince around the word genocide. If we deny, you know, the the Rohingya rights to call this what it is and to recognize the crime as a genocide, we are essentially denying, you know, the rights to be protected and the ability for Rohingya to actually be recognized as human. And basically, this is all another sort of erasure at another level, which is globally. For what I would hope in terms of actions that could be done, practically, there are a lot of things that Rohingya community has put out. Very few of them have been picked up by international community in order to be implemented. We're hoping, however, that there would be a shift of a perspective from Rohingya people in need to resilient, strong Rohingya survivors. And just this change of phrasing, change of you know, the wording, it can shift people's perspective into, you know, looking at Rohingya. Because let's face it, surviving a genocide is a skill. Surviving different forms of restrictions over, you know, so many decades need, you know, a lot of technicalities and skills for people to be able to even continue to live today. So we're undermining Rohingya's ability to contribute to the society if we're not recognizing that their survival to this day is incredible, and that in and of itself should be celebrated. Another point that I wanted to, you know, emphasize is that it is important for not only, you know, us to talk about the justice and accountability measures and what that looks like should come from the community themselves. However, there needs to be another emphasis, because retributive justice only, you know, serve us for so long. It would only sustain us for another maybe 2-3 years or maximum 10 years. What would sustain us is rehabilitation. And rehabilitation, what that looks like, again, there needs to be a better consultation of the community and better listening from the international community. There needs to be a lot more concerted effort in trying to implement what the Rohingya community has suggested, and further, you know, scrutiny of what currently goes on and what happens within the camps, or what happened inside Rakhine State, and how much aid and assistance could go into helping building people up, looking at Rohingya rather than just refugee people in need, you know, people who cannot help themselves. Rather, look at them as agents of change within the community, agents, you know, pillars of their own community, who could definitely find ways to not only, you know, push forward the community in survival mode, but if we're given more, we would be able to thrive more. And that's what I really, really hope the international community will take note. Thank you.
Thank you for that incredibly powerful articulation of just the resilience. And I can't underscore that enough. Any community that has survived genocide, and not just, you know, as we said at the introduction, one day of attack, but decades of attack. I mean, resilience is what you every single day express. I wanted, on the prevention question, Chin Kin, frame it in the context of your really remarkable efforts when it comes to advancing international criminal justice. Chin Kin is a hero to many of us and to many human rights lawyers around the world, many legal scholars and students, because you have been at the forefront of trying to pursue justice and accountability for the Rohingya community, and trying to tackle this kind of culture of impunity that, as Wei Wei said, has allowed the Tatmadaw to continue to perpetrate crimes, and also perpetrate crimes against other communities as well. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the justice efforts that you've been taking forward.
Thank you, Naomi. It is a very important question. When I went to the camps, and also my sisters, Mawi and Yasmin, we heard unitedly, we can see there, we want justice. We want justice. That is united voice from everyone. What they suffered, what they have passed through, I remember it today because I feel very emotional. When I saw the 10 minutes, the video, that's reminding me like 2017, August, end of September, first week I was in camp. So that's reminding me again and again, the stories and horrible, the way how they passed through. And I came to the hotel, I can't sleep at night, and it's terrible. So we Rohingyas, like, you know, as we have opportunities, I mean, thanks to Holocaust and other international lawyers, we have one thing we have to fulfill. We have to support, we have to show solidarity, we have to work for our community, one thing. Secondly, this justice with military enjoying impunity, we must work. On that side, we have now International Criminal Court, with thanks to Bangladesh supporting that deportation case. Gambia, we can never forget what a small country has stood up for our people. This is unbelievable. And those cases are going, and we, our organization, we file Argentinian judiciary case, universal jurisdiction case. The same week, fortunately, it's happened, which is historic justice week for Burma, everyone. You know, 10th of November, ICJ, 13th of November, Argentina won, 14th ICC open investigation. So very encouraging, to be honest. So we can see that recently, last few days ago, our case were able to open investigation. Thanks to our lawyer, Thomas Cantena, who is well-respected in Argentina, and he was most of Burma's work, who do they all know that he was UN Special Reporter for Burma 2008 to 2014. So he did a great work with Burmese Rohingya Organization UK, and we tried our best to open investigation. Now the case will move forward, fortunately. And this, we struggle, you know, to open before, last 2 years, we struggle a bit because ICC have a case, they are concerned on that. So Argentina, you know, we have seen, you know, Spain, Franco, you know, Franco case, and also, you know, other cases, they are very strong. And the military, during the Argentinian, you know, military era, they've been taken, they've been get rid of them. And so a kind of champion. And one thing from this case, what we can see is we will move very fast. IIMM, International Investigative Mechanism, is supporting the case. That is very good. And our focus this case is, you know, ICJ case is genocide case. ICC is deportation case. But as we feel emotional, we see what suffered our brothers and sisters, like Manu village, you know, Tulatuli, Chokping, Godaping, horrific brutalities they have done. These are the people they want justice. I mean, we remember that this kind of, we file on those, we are getting those investigations, you know, those evidence collecting from IIMM, and we have our own evidences, and I believe that then we can, that the judges will, you know, summon those criminal militaries, and if they don't come, I believe that we can do arrest warrant through Interpol. That will be a big encouragement. At least we can do something. One thing I want to highlight here is we are a people. We have our culture. We have our civilization. We belong to our Arkana state. That is our land. They've been taken away. Our grandfathers contributed many things for the country. So no matter how much Burmese military tried, they can never take away our rights, our identity, and our existence. We will do our best to get justice. One day, I believe we will see and we will win. When we talk justice, one thing I want to add a little bit, sorry. It's not only for the Rohingya, it's for the people of Burma. You know, today, what's happened to the Rohingya 2017? Today you can see other parts of Burma, what is happening. We can feel the pain for them. We all are facing, fighting for the common enemy, military criminals, Mi Onglaing and all other criminal junta leaders. So we will fight this common enemy together. I believe we will win, we will get justice.
I think that's the goal and the common will of everyone on this stage. And I just have to thank you, Tunkin, for your incredible leadership in this regard. You know, when we think in the historical context that today there are still cases being brought against alleged Nazi perpetrators, we know that the pursuit of justice is something that survivors will pursue throughout their lives. The efforts that you've made are truly remarkable. As you said, just in a very short period of time, there has been the creation of a UN International Investigative Mechanism, as you said, to collect, preserve, analyze evidence. We have seen the International Criminal Court case that you said, the investigation that's looking at deportation in the context of Bangladesh, the International Criminal International Court of Justice case that you talked about with the Gambia, and then your historic case in Argentina. And then now also in this past week, the case that's been brought against Facebook. So truly remarkable advances. The one thing we haven't seen is any accountability and justice really within the country, which is why you have to resort to all of these external avenues. And I'm hopeful that, as you said, what is done outside will have that transformative change for the community. It will also, though, help to set a historical record of what happened, which is so critically important. In that regard, I wanted to turn to you, Greg, to talk a bit about the exhibit. You know, your perspective of how, when you were taking the photos and helping to build the exhibit, your goal was not just to document what had happened, but it was really to also share it with the world to try to ensure that these crimes stop and that we prevent future crimes. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about how you think it contributes to this kind of prevention effort, but also the selection of the stories, the selection of the photos, so incredibly difficult for you to have to decide. It's such a complex narrative, and we only had three rooms to tell the story of a people. I remember walking in and seeing you with thousands of photos on the wall, trying to determine what narratives to tell, which images to use for the physical exhibit, for the online exhibit. Can you talk about the types of choices you had to make along the way in telling this story?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, well, for one, let's put it this way, that selection, that decisions that were being made as to how to tell the story, what is the best way, was not only informed by my own experiences, but it was also informed by a whole group of people that added in their perspectives into how best to tell this story in a way. And also at the same time, it required the involvement of an amazingly talented group of people from the museum to help guide the best way to tell that story. How do you translate this very complex story into a way within these three rooms, like you said, Naomi? I think for me, there were a couple different objectives that needed to be fulfilled. One of those objectives was that the human stories and the human voices of Rohingya had to be central throughout the whole entire exhibition. I mean, this was almost an exhibition where you wanted Rohingya to be guiding people through this story rather than a museum or a curator or whatever guiding them through. So having those voices was central to the whole entire exhibition. And we did that through, you know, selecting a certain number of Rohingya to tell their story through these three rooms, just like a story you would with the beginning, a middle, of an end, about what their life was like before 2017, what happened to them during 2017, and what their lives are like now after 2017. But also at the same time, I think another incredibly important part of that narrative of how we told this story was the process of what led up to 2017. I think in today's world, unfortunately, everybody is familiar with violence. Everybody has a visual translation in their heads of what genocide might look like based on past experiences of what's happened in the past. And what I really wanted to try to accomplish with this exhibition was to push people's understanding of what has happened to the Rohingya community as something that is just beyond 2017. So the first part of more of the historical narrative of this exhibition really almost forces people to have to understand the context behind what led to 2017, because we live in a world where everything is just being unwrapped from context. So until people could really truly understand all of the strategic and systematic things that took place in the decades leading up to 2017, they almost wouldn't fully appreciate the tragedy of the stories of the Rohingya who shared their stories in this exhibition in 2017. So there were very, very conscious decisions as to how we would structure the exhibition. And also at the same time, it was always trying to find ways to include the Rohingya involvement in telling that story. You know, in the second room of the exhibition, which is all central about what happened in 2017, you know, we incorporate mobile phone videos that Rohingya took of actually the violence, of the destruction, of the displacement. It's coming from their eyes, you know, and the stories and the voices that you hear are coming from their voices. And when it comes to loss and trauma, how do you translate that visually into a way that retains and preserves the dignity of people in that community? And for me, as I was working on creating the pictures over all of these years, one thing that came up was, at least in the last 2 years of working on it after the violence, was when you would talk with someone about a family member who had been killed in 2017. They would talk about what they saw and the trauma of what they saw of their loved one being killed. But eventually it would always turn into them talking about who that person was. A wife, a husband, a storekeeper, a merchant, you know, an imam, an educated person who went to Sitwe University. I mean, those are all the things that, like, through these pictures, through selfies that we all carry on our phones today, that is how we and I wanted to represent who these people were that were lost. Because when you really look at these photographs, you truly start to understand how systematic the violence was, in the sense that the people that were targeted for a large extent in a lot of these massacres that took place in 2017 were the people who were the most important fabric of Rohingya society. They were the imams, they were the merchants, they were the wives, they were the mothers, all of these people. And they need to be represented in that sense as just how their family members remember them. Because I feel like we have to demand a lot from people these days. This exhibition demands a lot from visitors. And I don't think we would want it any other way. Because the Rohingya and the story of the Rohingya demand that. And I hope that we accomplished it in those 3 800 square feet rooms. I think we have come close, but just like all three of you have said, there is just so much more that has to be done, and so much more storytelling that needs to be done. And I think that, building on the question that you asked to Weiwei, the fact is that, you know, this is the time for Rohingya voice, you know? And although it's so crucial for photographers and journalists from the international community to continue to keep investigating and telling those stories. There's an opportunity right now for Rohingya to have a voice that they have been fighting for a long time. And that can be through following young Rohingya photographers who are making incredible pictures in the camp of what their daily life is like and translating their memories into something that is very intimate and personal. You know, following Rohingya poets at Art Garden about how they're translating through the artistic means the trauma and the lost and their visions and their dreams for what they see as young youth from the Rohingya community and how they see their future. I mean, this is the time for those voices to be amplified even more than what they are right now. And I hope that this exhibition, I think we all hope who are involved in this. And again, it was an amazing team of very, very talented people being guided by Rohingya. I think we really hope that this is just the starting point for more of these stories to be told all over the world, to be honest with you, not just here in Washington, D.C.
Thank you, Greg. You know, I and many of us are in awe of what you did and what the entire team has done. As you said, it's a remarkable effort by so many parts of the museum to work with you to tell the story and to work with our Rohingya colleagues to do that. I think for us, something that's so critically important and that inspires us as an institution is we want to try to do for communities today what was not done for the Jews of Europe. And it goes without saying that many Jewish survivors were not included in the process of telling their own story, unfortunately, for decades. So it's an honor to be able to share the stage with all of you today to try to make sure that we rectify that for your community and do so in an ethical manner. Sometimes the human rights field feels a little bit too extractive. We come, we hear the stories, we take it, and there's a failure to go back and actually make sure that the communities are informed, know that people care, see that action is taken, but more importantly, that your communities have a seat at the table as well and your voices are being heard. So Greg, thank you for incorporating those principles into everything that you do and into the story that you've been trying to tell. I think it's a tragedy that we have to even do this, that we have to have the exhibit. Again, it speaks to the failure and something that we're trying to unfortunately rectify, so that we do not have to do this in the future with other communities. The photo that Greg was talking about with the images, just to really underscore for everyone who's watching at home, every face on that screen, on the cell phone, that's representative of someone who no longer exists today. And just to think about the sheer terror of the individuals who had to flee, usually with virtually nothing that they can bring other than their cell phone. This is a representation that they have of their loved ones. Incredibly powerful image and one that all of us have seen in many instances, and also not just with the Rohingya community, I thinking in the documentation of the Yazidi community's genocide as well, that represents their communities. So really powerful images, Greg. I wanted to just end by asking each of you, if there was one message that you hope that visitors to the exhibition walk away with, what would it be? Yasmin, I'm going to start with you.
I think I'm going to just reiterate what I have said earlier, but I want to basically say that Rohingya people are no less humans than anyone else on this earth. And I think the systematic process of genocide that took place to erase us, to eliminate our existence, to ensure that we no longer have the ability to exercise our agency or all, but you know, a larger plan to actually dim our light. And the way that you can help us very, very directly today, right here at this moment, is to shift your perspective and look at us just like you look at your neighbor, your friends, your family, and view us just as equal, as human as you are, because all of these photos and everyone that has made the exhibit possible, especially from the Rohingya community, have a lot of stories to tell, as Greg and you know my colleagues have said. It's their stories that you should relate to, because it's not just a story of survivors of genocide, but it's a human struggle story. It's a struggle to find peace, to come to terms with their own ability to exist on this earth and to make something of this life. Thank you.
Thank you, Yasmin. Weiwei.
Thank you, Yasmin. And thank you, everybody, again, for your incredible work and for your for this like rich discussions. And I want to specifically thank to you, Greg, for this, for your vision, for your objective, and for all of this creation. It's truly we're truly grateful, and it's truly special for the Rohingya survivors and victims and for all of us. So seeing this exhibit and this very important historical museum side by side with the Holocaust history. Holocaust is deemed to be the worst form of atrocity and crimes, genocide and ethnic cleansing in the history. But now seeing our suffering, our community's suffering presented side by side in the this very museum, it shows it's very important for us, and it's it shows genocide can happen everywhere. And there are, although the gravity and the scale and everything in different contexts, including the Holocaust, is completely different, but it shows the genocide can happen, the community can be targeted, a group they belong to the ethnic or religious or other specific group can be targeted for genocide anywhere. And similar warning signs are similar everywhere. And the world is repeatedly failing to take actions and to end the genocide. Therefore, my message should be, my message is actually to take action, because don't ignore all of these warning signs and take, like, stand for the Rohingya, help Rohingyas to bring justice. At the same time, when you see this hate speech that can lead to this tragic genocide, stop it. Take actions from the beginning everywhere around the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Weiwei. Greg.
I mean, you know, the three of you are speak about what that message should be, to be honest with you. I mean, I don't think I'm in a position to say that. But I think the one thing that I can say with 100% confidence is that I think that people should be coming and seeing this exhibition. And I think that people should be seeing it online, because it goes beyond the three walls in Wexner. I mean, it's available for people everywhere. And people should really take advantage of that, because I do think that they can learn quite a great deal, that through the story of the Rohingya, they can learn quite a great deal about what else is happening out in the rest of the world these days. But I think that that's, if there's anything that I could ask that I think is of relevance sitting among three of you, it would be for people to be coming and seeing this exhibition, or to be visiting it online and discussing it and learning about it and asking questions about it that not only relate to the Rohingya, but open up a door to reflecting on what's happening in your own community as well. And I think that that's one of the most important things that actually can be asked from me, from people, is just that.
Thank you, Greg. And Chun Ken.
This exhibition means personally a lot to me, first thing. When I enter the exhibit, when Burma, we belong to Burma, the first, when parliamentarians, I've seen my grandfather pictures and elderly Rohingyas, that part reminding me how we contributed for our country. And secondly, when I passed through, like, 1982 citizenship law, Ne-win, Kinyun, and those pictures, that time around, you know, I was not able to go to university. And that part I have seen. And because of that, I'm lucky one to be here today, to be honest. Many of my friends been killed or in camps today, so I can feel for them that. When we move forward a bit, we saw 2017 August, the video, that reminding the stories, what I heard, what I passed through, this is really heartening and heartbreaking. That is first thing, my personally. For the message for the people, one thing is, in this 21st century, how could this be happen? A community, they have everything burned down and, you know, denying existence, denying identity, denying the right to have food and denying your citizenship and creating popular biases, hate speech and pushing you to the camps and, you know, you become already without, homeless, and you, in your country, your native land, you become without land, without your identity. So we need to learn that that one thing is, whoever come, there is one thing. There is, we can never give up. Things are possible. We have to push for the justice for Rohingya people and rebuilding this community. And also we have to remember that when we talk justice, the community, they should support their countries, I mean international, the countries should support ICJ case and, you know, ICC referral, Security Council, that we need to continue. And last thing, you know, new Burma, everybody looking at now. Now the coup leader, you can see last of the online picture, what he mentioned in Washington Post and unfinished business, what he mentioned. So now what's happened to these days to Burma, Rohingya headlight been disappeared, genocide is still ongoing. But other parts of Burma, this criminal, you know, this criminal leader, I mean, this murderer, mass murderer, me online is still ordering to kill other people of Burma. So this is going on right now. I mean, yesterday, today, and maybe continue. To stop that, we need to do, to get justice first and supporting, you know, for the inclusive Burma, Rohingya should not be left out when we fight this time. And I can see that there will still, we will not give up. There will, we will have hope. So we will fight for justice. That's reminding me again when six women who were giving witness to our case in Argentina, I can see the courage of our sisters who suffered. They told their stories. This is unbelievable. Is it a bit, and why a bit unbelievable to talk in our culture? I mean, they have courage to speak up for what's happened to them. This is what's happened to my sisters. That's really encouraging me. And unfortunately, they have courage to fight for what's happened to them. But international community, other governments should have more courage to fight for this justice for the Rohingya. Thank you. I stop here.
Thank you so much, Chunkin, for that incredibly powerful call to action to not abandon your community and remember that the courage that you show every single day, we need to see even an iota of that at the international level. Maybe just picking up on your theme of home. Yasmin, you have written a poem about the yearning for home. You yourself had to grow up in exile. Chunkin, you also had to flee in order to even have a future in education. Weiwei, you were put in prison as a teenager because your father was appointed to parliament. It's a theme that you all know well. I'd like to just, in closing, Trinity Yasmin is going to share a poem with us, first in the Rohingya language and then also a poem in English.
Thank you very much, Naomi. And thank you again for you know, for the ability, for the opportunity for us all to be here together and for us to witness a history being made today on the launch of the Burma's Path to Genocide exhibit. I need to give a little bit of information about this very specific poem. I actually got it from the Rohingya Art Garden. And this poem was written by Miss Zad M. So shout out to her. The title is Mon Hander Talaboli. Zodi Tori Tonnam Furai Zagwe Dunya Paganotase Ful Doriatase Fani Tore Sara Tainofari O Ar Shundori Ar Monhander Tolaboli Ar Monhander Tolaboli. The rough translation is I'm crying inside for you, and that's the title. The rough translation of this specific poem is that if I would ever be able to call you again, I would let this whole world just crumble. And even in the garden, there are flowers. In the sea, there are water. But I can't live without you. The poet went to say that I'm crying inside of you. I'm crying inside for you, oh my beautiful. And I find that it's very much related to another poem that I wrote about my yearning for home. And one thing about erasure is that it kind of disconnects me from my own culture and from, you know, the ability to read poems like this. It's so beautiful in our language. The ability to be able to read my own language in and expressing it in poetry is so powerful, and I don't know how to express it in words. So I'm just going to read this poem to you. A part of home I never got to see. Genocide, tyrants, thief. Knowing my heart will always ache for a touch of this faded memory. A little bit of connection, family. What price should I pay to get back this stolen history? And the title is Uprooted. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Yasmin. It's a privilege for us to be able to hear you give those poems. I want to thank our audience for joining us this morning. A recording of today's event is now available on Facebook and will be available in the Rohingya, Burmese, and Arabic languages in the coming days. Just in conclusion, I just want to remind everyone who's watching, this genocide was not inevitable. The warning signs were numerous, as were the opportunities to halt the crimes. The world has failed the Rohingya community, and we can't continue to do so. We must protect the Rohingya from future attacks and ensure that those who are responsible are held accountable. The Rohingya people deserve a safe return to Burma, to be recognized as full citizens in their own country, and to be reintegrated into the political and cultural life in Burma as they were before. We cannot go back in time and prevent what should never have happened. But just in conclusion, what we can do and what each of you can do is fight for justice for Rohingya victims and survivors, combat genocide denial by the Burmese government, and support the Rohingya community in their quest for safety, security, cultural preservation, and human dignity.